Greetings and welcome. Welcome here to this auditorium of the University of Otago and to this this evening's discussion around the afterlife. In our Māori traditions, our ancestors are such a huge part of what make us who we are. They are always remembered in our hearts and always remembered in our minds. And we have a saying where we say, although they may have been buried by the blade of a shovel, we resurrect them again with the blade in our mouth, our tongue. And when we talk about them and we remember them, and their memory is what brings them back to us. And it's that important part of being human and our humanity, where we hold on to those emotions and we remember our loved ones, whether they are our parents, our grandparents, or maybe we lost children, or whoever it is that we may have in our whakaaro, or huri tuara, where they've turned their back on us. He whakaaro no tātou, ka ki atu tātou ōpō whetungangiti. We also talk about our departed as those who have become stars in the sky. He tika o ki rā e rā kōrero o te o ngā kaipūtai o Rongonui, no ngā whetū tonu tātou e tu aimi. And it brings me to some of the science knowledge that we talk about, where we are all made of stardust. And so as our bodies become part of papa tūnuku and back to part of our natural environment, we return back to the stardust from which our world was created. Nō reira, I runga I tēnā tātou e mihi nei, kia koutou, o tāmai ki te whakaaro, ki te āta wetewete, ki te āta whakatewhatewha I ēne kaupapa. And so you tonight, as you're here to listen, to discuss, to pull apart all these different ideas that we have about the afterlife, I greet you all, no mai, no mai, haere mai.
Yeah.
wanna mo te tupuna rā a te rua hiki hiki mo ona tupuna hoki ko rātou rā ngā poupou o te whare a ko a rātou kōrero a ko ngā tuinga o roto i te whare nā reira ko taua whare rā ka kōrero atu mo te tūāpapa o te iwi e noho nei i te iwi rana. That song talks about an ancestor te rua hiki hiki and his ancestors, and those people are likened to the posts in our wharenui. And in our wharenui, all of our histories are told. And so that song, for the people of today, from their ancestors' past, reminds them of their deeds, reminds them of their place here in Dunedin and Otago, and we love to share that with you tonight. Nā reira, tēnā koutou, nau mai, nau mai, hai.
Great pleasure to welcome you to the opening night of ScienceTeller 2019. My name is Jesse Baring. I am the director of the Center for Science Communication and one of the co-organizers of tonight's event, along with my colleague Jamin Haberstadt, here from the Psychology Department. Now, before we begin, I've got a couple of items of business to get out of the way. First of all, there is the matter of bathrooms. And you just simply go out the back door here the way that you came, and down the stairs you'll find the bathrooms on the ground floor. Fire evacuation, in the unlikely event that we're going to have some sort of fire-related issue, simply go down those same stairs and go out that area, out that front door, and gather at the Child Development Center, which is adjacent to this building, and in case it's raining, or unpleasant in terms of the weather, we can move you to the Robertson Library. And finally, in the exceptionally unlikely event there's an earthquake, do not leave the building until the shaking has stopped. And then you're free to exit in that same manner. Now, back to the event itself for which we are all gathered. That sounds a little strange. Back to the Science Teller event. This is something that happens with the generous contributions from a variety of donors, namely our very own University of Otago. And this biennial event is regularly hosted by the Center for Science Communication, which is the home of storytelling and science and one of the world's leading academic departments for the teaching, research, and practice of science communication. We are located actually just down the road in the Ofeo building, and if you're interested in learning more about us, I encourage you to visit our departmental booth, which is located just outside of the entrance here, and you can speak to some of our lovely postgraduate students that are presently in the course. They can tell you a little bit more about the Center for Science Communication. Now, if you're unfamiliar with ScienceTeller, every 2 years, we settle on a theme that essentially is meant to engage and inspire scientifically informed conversations in our community here in Dean about some provocative topic, let's say. So last time we did this, it was all about the science of sexuality, and we brought in the American, very well-known sex advice columnist Dan Savage as our keynote speaker, and he shared with us his wisdom on everything from polyamory to kink to what it takes to have and sustain a good, happy, long-term marriage. This time around, ScienceTeller is all about science and the afterlife. And I'll tell you more about that in a moment. But tonight's featured guest actually articulates very nicely with the theme of the last ScienceTeller, because she knows a thing or two about sex as well. this is what I hear. having written the best-selling book, Bonk, The Curious Coupling of Science and Sex, and maybe that will find its way in the conversation at some point.
Well, I hope so.
and that was the one, if you're unfamiliar with Mary Roach, that she and her husband, Ed, hi Ed, I'm not sure where you are, but you're somewhere here, they had intercourse in an MRI machine in the name of science. And that's the kind of intrepid reporter that Mary Roach is. Now that's just one of the many, many juicy topics that the inimitable Mary Roach has sunk her teeth into over her extraordinary career as a popular science writer and humorist. In fact, we could actually do any number of Science Teller themes in which Mary would be the ideal person to have on this stage. With her striking ability to translate complex science so that the average reader can appreciate both the beauty and the oftentimes ridiculous yet hilarious absurdity of the world in which they live, Mary, according to one reviewer, manages to, quote, make the creepy funny. She has written about, to name just a few topics, the unexpected uses of corpses and the processes of human decomposition. This is in her book, Stiff, The Curious Lives of Human Cadavers. She's written about the interplanetary space flight, the science of interplanetary space flight and packing for Mars, the secret life of the digestive system in Gulp, adventures on the alimentary canal, military science in Grunt, the curious science of humans at war, and of course, that slippery subject of souls and the afterlife, which is why we're lucky enough to have her here with us tonight. In that book, Spook, Science Tackles the Afterlife, Mary ventured into that age-old matter of what exactly becomes of our personal consciousness when we die. Her reporting journey in writing that book is going to be the subject of tonight's conversation. We kick off ScienceTeller then with this intimate conversation featuring Mary Roach, but note that this is just the start of it. This is just the beginning of a three-day celebration and, in fact, sort of an interrogation of the science of the afterlife. So be sure to check out the program for the full ScienceTeller event. It includes a wide range of talks about some of the latest research into people's afterlife beliefs, a scientifically informed eschatological debate on life after death, a screening of the critically acclaimed TV show Wellington Paranormal, this mockumentary series, which includes a Q&A with one of the producers of the series, Paul Yates, and a closing Sunday keynote by none other than the arch skeptic and author Michael Shermer, who you actually might have seen in last night's The Project being interviewed. So on behalf of my colleagues at the Center for Science Communication and the Department of Psychology, welcome again to Science Teller, and we hope that by Sunday evening, let's say, you'll have a more critically minded and maybe even a more compassionate understanding of just why people believe what they do when it comes to the prospect of our everlasting souls. In the words of tonight's guest, the most staunchly held views are based on ignorance or accepted dogma, not carefully considered accumulations of facts. The more you expose the intricacies and realities of the situation, the less clear-cut things become. Not to get ahead of ourselves, but I tend to agree with Mary on that point. So before we begin our conversation, would you please join with me in giving a very warm and even welcome to the Mary Roach.
So Mary,
thank you, Jesse.
You are very welcome.
A series of questions for you related to your experiences in the paranormal or afterlife related field.
Yes.
And I know, I think you don't like personal questions necessarily in terms of your own anomalous experiences. With that in mind, can you tell me about your first experiences with death? What's the first time that you sort of encountered this very weighty subject matter?
Not a pet.
Either.
First experience with death. That really comes to mind, I guess, my mother. My mother passed away, in my 30s, and
later was hit by a car and I see the dead cat in the middle of the road.
Oh.
And that really forced me to
have to figure that out.
I was sort of left my own devices, I think, but I do remember feeling like they had gone somewhere. I remember writing a letter to them.
Oh.
Tearing up the letter and throwing it into the wind.
Oh, wow.
And had to read the letter. That's a very bright child.
No, I do remember the first pet death. It was a cat named Josie, and I remember my parents had a jigsaw puzzle, and I was too young to really do anything but put the pieces on the floor. But I had a little chain, like a necklace, and I was moving it through the jigsaw puzzle pieces, and my mother came in and said, Josie got hit. I don't know how she phrased it, but I remember that being my first experience with that. But I don't remember. I didn't write a letter. I didn't tear it. I think I just kept playing with the little chain.
Yeah.
I don't know how to.
We share that traumatic experience with Susan.
It didn't spark any profound reaction.
Right. So you mentioned your first book, Stiff. Which sort of set the stage for this conversation about, I mean, that whole book was about the really sort of curious uses, both in history and scientifically, of the carcass of human horses.
Right. Yes.
In particular.
I mean,
just cadaver. Yeah, I'm sorry. Carcass is a little.
So
one can see an obvious connection with. The next book that you wrote, which was Spook.
Right.
But how did you, tell us a little bit about that journey. Yeah.
One book to the next.
Yeah.
Stiff, one of the things I wrote about in Stiff was the use of the body, the dead body, in the search for the soul. In other words, a long time ago, before anyone had sort of figured out what all the bits and pieces were for, there were various theories. Like the Babylonians believed the liver was the seat of the soul. And if you see the liver, it's a very kind of beautiful, streamlined looking, solid, boss kind of organ. I could imagine thinking centrally located, sleek. You could imagine thinking you didn't know what a liver did, well, maybe that's the soul. And then, you know, things moved on. It quickly became. Because of injuries to the brain and the changes in personality, there then became a suspicion of a head maybe somewhere in here, and the pineal gland, because it's not paired, just one, so that little item, because its actual use wasn't known, that was a novelty. And I found that kind of fascinating, that learned men of science had attempted to physically locate the soul, to figure it out, to use science in the pursuit of understanding, does the soul exist? Where is it housed? What does it do? You know, so that kind of led to my idea for Spook.
So your first two book topics were about death and.
Cadavers is sort of post-death, but yeah, you could say death, not the dying part of it, but the being dead part of it. Yeah.
So going into, you know, transitioning from Stiff to Spook.
Yeah.
What were your thoughts about this line of paranormal related research? Did you have would you consider yourself a skeptic? Did you go into it open-minded? Were you a believer?
Not a believer. I was the kind of kid. My mom was a good rule following Catholic. She took me to church every Sunday.
So you grew up in New Hampshire.
I grew up in New Hampshire. My mom was quite Catholic. My dad was an atheist. My dad wouldn't set foot in the church, partly because he'd been raised in England as a Catholic, which meant school stopped in eighth grade because you were going to work in a factory. It was lower class. Catholicism meant lower class poverty. Anyway, so he kind of renamed himself when he came to the U.S. So, but my mother was very, very Catholic. She would read the Bible to me, and she would show me that she had a Bible with colored plates, like the walls of Jericho coming down. And I was the kind of annoying kid, or annoying to her, who would go like, don't you think it's possible there was an earthquake around the time, they were blowing the horns, and that's kind of why they fell down? Doesn't that make more sense? Or like, walk Jesus walking on water, maybe this is there, like some of those age holes, they're just below the water. Maybe he looked like he was walking on the water. That, so that was my mindset, not for I don't know what the reason would be. I mean, my dad never pushed that on me. I just was that's how I approached the world, I guess, much to my mother's dismay.
So that was your starting point with this reporting.
Yeah, that was my starting point. You know, Spook is not a book that set out to convince anybody one way or the other. It was really just a kind of joyful examination of people thinking outside the box when it comes to the challenge of figuring out, is there an afterlife?
Scientific exploration.
Yeah, like somebody trying to use scientific method or cryptography or near-death experience, ways to just to find some kind of proof. So it was just kind of an escapade through that world. And I tried to stick to academics and university-based researchers, so there are about three. There's the University of Virginia, which had an endowment from Chester Carlson, the inventor of the Xerox machine, whose wife was very interested in the persistence of personality after death and left a lot of money, as you know, to UVA. And they still do at that department, I believe.
Well, can I ask you if you've ever had any anomalous experiences yourself that have kind of lingered with you that you've struggled to rationalize?
I had nothing really super fun, I'm sorry to say, but I'll give you my rather drab paranormal experience, which was many years ago. I was living with somebody in San Francisco, and around Valentine's Day, we had a party. So we had some of those little hearts. I don't know if you have those here, these little candy hearts that have little weird...
No, Valentine's Day is gone.
Those little candy hearts with the messages like, love, yeah. Anyway, there was, I know there are seven or eight at least per bag, and I'm forgetting all of them. Hot love, maybe. One morning, I come into the kitchen, and on the kitchen table, and right in the middle, is a little heart, and it says, no use. I'm like, what's that doing there? I don't know, it's really weird. And I assumed that my boyfriend had put it there. For some reason, I don't know what he was trying to get at, and he said no. So I didn't believe him. I thought, okay, he must have done that. Fast forward many, many years when I'm writing Spook, and we split up, and he moved to Germany, and he was long gone. And I emailed him, and I said, I'm writing this book. I really need to know. Remember when the heart showed up on the table? Was that you? And he swore it was not, which is not, like, so he could be lying. Anyway, but he said no, so that was not me.
No use.
No use. Well, we were our house was
a little. Little.
People upstairs were creaky. Anyway, that's about.
That's the extent of it, you're anomalous.
What about you?
I've had a handful, actually, that I've struggled to reconcile with my otherwise.
As good as that little no use heart?
One was around the same time that cat died, and I wrote a love letter to the cat. I came downstairs, and in the bathroom waste bin, in the trash can, there was a load of bloody napkins or tissues, which is going in a slightly different direction. Here you go. We can avoid that. Topic. It does connect to some of your other work, but anyway, that's a story that just didn't come from that.
And how many people were living there?
Five.
Five people.
Nobody knew where these bloody tissues came from, but at least that's still with them. The other was when I was maybe 12. I was always very frightened and paranoid of ghosts. I mean, I have this fear of
ghosts.
Not so much ghosts. I have a very very potent fear of ghosts and spirits. And I remember lying in my bed one night. I sent a sort of ritualistic chant to ward them off. I would die of fright if a ghost somehow appeared spontaneously. And I was saying this chant in my head, and it just occurred to me that, you know, if the bathroom light across the hall from my bedroom suddenly flashed on, that would be too much. Like, it would just be overwhelming for me. And it did. And I screamed at my sister's bedroom.
You're how old?
That's probably 12, a little bit too old to be having these types of problems. But that happened, and I still can't explain that. But that was one of my sort of anomalous experiences. Which leads me, I guess, to the question of how do you handle these rich, vivid anecdotes when people have come to you in the wake of...
Yes, and everyone has one, it seems. I would do signings, talks and signings, and people would come up and they would share these stories.
Yeah.
And also, on the radio, they, you know, open up the line to callers, and people would have these stories. And what I started doing, I stole a line from, you guys probably don't know this show, Coast to Coast AM. It's a show, I'm sure Michael Shermer knows, Coast to Coast AM. It's a late night program, and it deals with all kinds of like paranormal conspiracy theories and alien abduction, etc. And I've been on the show a couple of times. I actually kind of love being on the show. It's from 12 to 3 a.m. Around about 2 a.m. they open up the phone lines, and you get some really interesting phone calls. What I noticed that the host would do, someone would tell this story about a ghost or something that had happened, he would just say, "Boy, that is really eerie." And that's there's no judgment. It's not, oh, do you think that actually you could explain it this way, or, oh my God, that is definitely a ghost. I mean, I would just say, wow, that's really eerie, or that's a great story. I would also say, you're really lucky, because I would love to have a seriously spooky, inexplicable experience like that. The heart is really not, the little heart, and it's nothing.
That?
No, I've got like your life going on. That's pretty cool.
Yeah. I've had others too, but that was probably the most intense.
Let's not get that one quite yet. Did you still have sort of a lingering feel that was some, that there was a connection between what you were thinking and the light?
I remember having a conversation with Bruce Grayson, who's the head of this Division of Perceptual Studies at the University of Virginia, that you mentioned earlier. And I explained this particular incident with him. And he said, well, that might not have been an actual haunting or a ghost intervening, having access to your thoughts and making this event happen, but it could have been some form of telekinesis that you were thinking about it, and your thought made a light flicker on and off. That wasn't terribly good.
Well, that makes perfect sense.
We think the afterlife out of the equation, at least, with that scenario.
Yes.
But I am...
Did you ever have any other seemingly telekinetic, I'm thinking this and now it's...
No, I've had dreams, you know, sort of precognition, where I dream about somebody that has, you know, visited me and has their day, and then they die the next day or something like that. I've had a couple of dreams like that.
None about me the past few days.
No, just so I don't know what basically this is actually one of the topics that I'm currently investigating in my own research program is what do you do with these anomalous events that don't match your otherwise scientific worldview.
Yeah.
For me, I kind of quarantine them. I put them aside. And
yes.
I haven't grappled with them in a way that is entirely gratifying.
Right, right. I had one other, which was, again, the boyfriend that I lived with. There was a red...
Oh, now it comes down.
Oh, it was a red pepper. For some reason, I don't know, it was on the top of the refrigerator. Why did we keep a pepper on the top of the refrigerator? Anyway, but it had these hack marks, like somebody had got, chopped it like that with a blade. And I didn't do it, and he didn't do it. Or so he said. So it was both. That was very strange for both of us. What happened to the pepper? I similarly like to keep those stories as a little bit of mystery to put money on what caused the pepper, I would say, A, David did it. B, I don't know, someone came, it fell on the floor and it was one of those, you know, something hit it and it kind of burst and it looked like somebody hacked it. And I even was like, oh, it looks like that part in Tarot deck with the swords through.
Yeah.
But,
and likewise, I would say that in all probability, it was probably some sort of, like, the light incident was probably some sort of electrical fault or just happened to be coinciding with my illumination at that moment.
Right. But freaky.
But definitely, I can see why people would be vulnerable to these types of attributions in light of those types of experiences. So you talk about several. So there are anecdotes, which you'll get no shortage of people sort of coming to you with colorful, idiosyncratic examples of hard to explain phenomena. But in the book, you really do a great job dissecting systematic, empirically based approaches to this question of whether personal consciousness survives death.
Mm-hmm.
Historically, there have been a number frameworks to investigate this phenomenon. One of them, we share an interest in this, I think, is the work by Ian Stevenson at the University of Virginia on reincarnation. So maybe you can set the stage for our audience here to share with them the nature of his work and what he was claiming.
Yeah. Well, Ian Stevenson was one of the University of Virginia, one of the beneficiaries of the Chester Carlson endowment.
The founder of the Xerox machine.
Yes, left millions.
Millions. Okay.
To the University of Virginia, specifically for the study of the persistence of personality after death. And it's, you know, it's university-based, so they tried to do it in a scientific way, sort of. So the two avenues that they mostly look into are reports of reincarnation, and then also near-death experience.
And he was an established scientist. He was a psychiatrist.
Yes, he's an MD. He had a respectable CV, for sure.
Before he went to the paranormal.
Before he went off into reincarnation. And I wrote to Ian Stevenson, he was toward the end of his career, he was in his 80s then, and he sent me in the direction of someone in India who, Dr. Rawat, who runs the Reincarnation Research Center, which turns out to be a small room off of his bedroom. Kirti Rawat is his name, and so he's the one. I mean, I did not meet Ian Stevenson. Maybe you can share more about.
He was down at the time I got there.
Okay. The work that was done in India is very different. Here, when you hear someone talk about, they believe that they were reincarnated, it's often, I was Caesar's horse, or I was the Queen of Sheba, or I was Cleopatra.
Yeah.
A lot of Cleopatras, there's a lot of, like,
it's really an acclaimed.
Yes, and in India, it's quite different. It's a small child, and they tend to be between 2 and 4. These children, around 5, it stops. Between 2 and 4, when they start to speak, they start referring to things that don't make sense to their parents. Names, they'll talk about memories and things that don't fit their current life. The parents will then sort of wonder, who died in the area, in the surrounding area, villages. The word kind of gets out. This kid is saying this, this, and this, and people will kind of. It's kind of an exciting game of sort of a mystery for everyone to solve. Who died around the time the child was born? Is this child the reincarnation of that person who died? So Kirti Rawat goes around with a video camera, and it's almost more like police detective work. He's trying to get past the game of telephone. I heard so-and-so say that he saw the child, and he said the child said, you know, so he's like, who saw it? Who heard it? So he's trying to get back to the firsthand accounts. And so I went with him on one of these investigations
in a very small Indian village,
yes. It was absolutely fascinating. It was interesting for me as the person, you know, not a strong case. You know, my sense was that he didn't believe in reincarnation, and he was kind of more looking for evidence for it than trying to, you know, objectively really get to the bottom of it. But anyway, I was very much sort of poking holes in, you know, he would describe a case and say, well, the child said, you know, he lived in a, you know, three-walled hut, and he had, and there were cows. It was like, can't be, that's every house in this village. You know, there was a lot of that kind of vague thing. And then we went, there was one day when we went with the small child, who was supposedly the reincarnation of this guy who electrocuted himself somehow. And we went with the small child to the father of the electrocuted man. And so the families came together, and the moment where this father took this little boy on his lap, and the father believed that this was his dead son reincarnated.
And I remember you saying that that's
it was like a big party, and the families got together, and it was this sort of joyous, fun event, and this connection between these two families. And I'm like, I'm such a jerk. And you're like, I don't know about that. Seems a little bit vague to me. I'm not even sure, you know. So it really is like, look, if it's true or not, who gives a shit?
So there's a pragmatic value.
Yeah, right.
And that's alleviating.
Yes, exactly.
And I was completely sympathetic to that. I remember my mother was dying of cancer. She had to give a couple of months left and went to the museum. And there was an exhibit where the idea was to write down one's sort of wishes and put it in a slot, and maybe the universe would sort of see to it to make that happen. And I was, at that stage, more adamant or vitriolic might be a little bit strong, but I was definitely more of a sort of argumentative skeptic, and I was telling her that this doesn't make any sense, and how can you believe that? And I remember her responding, well, that's, you know, just let me believe, just allow me to have this moment.
Yeah.
Right. And I felt like an asshole, like, why was I pushing my lack of belief on her when this brought her some degree of pleasure or relief from the anxiety?
Yeah, comfort, yes. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. No, I envy people like my mother.
That doesn't make it true, but I appreciated that sentiment.
My mother believed very strongly when she dies, as long as she, you know, had the proper mass at the end of her life and sort of did everything the right way, and that when she died, that she was going to heaven. And those people are the lucky people, because either they do go to heaven or they never find out they were wrong, so they live their whole life to be. It's going to be even better, or I'm going to Adam. So
what do you do with those cases? And we talked about this a little bit earlier. Ian Stevenson had this massive tome called Biology and Reincarnation, and he was basically trying to map out the morphology or the physical characteristics of the child with the previous personality.
Yes.
So he even had a couple of cases of the child who was, I don't know, 6-7 years old, who had congenital abnormalities that matched the autopsy photos of the previous personality, the person that they said they reincarnated as. So somebody that was, you know, missing a couple of fingers, died in some horrific accident.
Right.
Long or something like that.
Yes, right.
And it was a very unusual genetic abnormality. So what do you do with these really, not convincing necessarily, but hard to explain cases that are difficult to generalize in some sort of sense of psychological?
Well, you have to refresh my memory. Were these, okay, when you take the person that had the lawnmower accident and the person with the mangled hand, were these people who claimed to have had some?
Yes. Yeah. So the same. So
they were. So, okay. So there was a belief that one had been reincarnated in the other.
So they were giving this sort of detailed, descriptive information about the household or the life of this person that died in that particular manner.
And then who was the person they were? How were they finding the other?
Ian Stevenson.
So what is to keep just like going door to door and going, remember seeing all of those, and there's
or like birthmarks or something.
Yeah, or even things like a fear of cats, and then I mean they were very, you know, they were personality quirks as
yes.
well, and he was kind of matching them up, but I'm a little fuzzy on exactly how what the relationship between the two was, but it's not really new. It's similar to remember maternal impressions.
Yes.
There's a belief that if a pregnant woman had a fright where she fell down the stairs, like that the baby would then have, there'd be some manifestation in the child, like a birthmark that looked like a staircase, like that. That kind of thing was common, I don't know, 1700, 1800.
Right.
So it's sort of, it's kind of that all over again.
Right.
I was amazed by that. I mean, it was like an 800-page. He was tireless. He was obsessed. He was driven. I don't know how did he find all of his?
I think that was one of the complaints, was that most of the cases of child reincarnation were in India, where there was that
right.
system. Anyways.
Oh, okay. So these were similar cases to what I described.
Yeah.
Okay. They were in India. All right. That's right. And they were in Burma as well. They were in cultures that have a belief in
India.
Yeah,
that did remind me a little
also,
bit.
Which also, you know, it's interesting that those are the cultures that, you know, because that's your expectation. Whereas in the United States, if a small child talks about, you know, a name that's not recognizable, you might say, oh, that's your imaginary friend.
Right.
You wouldn't say, oh, what, who are you reincarnated as?
That's the cultural script.
Yeah.
But these are the cases that, you know, the ones that sort of stand out as being hard to reconcile or to somehow explain in materialistic ways. What do you do with them? Like, one thing that connected the dots with me was you talk about a medium who, you know, she was off on a lot of things, but she got something very specific, which was
right,
that
right.
she talked about seeing metal hourglasses and the fact that...
Oh, an hourglass, yes.
Yeah.
Yeah, I was going to say, with what you were just talking about, the Ian Stevenson, you know, matching the two up, a missing finger is one physical trait out of dozens. I mean, you could, whatever you need to match up, you could probably find something on the human... I mean, you know, you could, if you're looking for it, probably find it. I spent time at the University of Arizona with some
Gary Schwartz,
yes, who is an academic and brings mediums in and had me sit with this woman, Alison Dubois, who was the medium for the TV show Medium. She was the inspiration for it. Anyway, so she did a thing, a cold read, with me, and at one point said, I'm getting an hourglass. Did you turn over an hourglass? And I said, oh, my brother collects hourglasses. And Gary Schwartz was like, oh my God. And I said, all right, okay, first of all, she said 50 things about me that don't relate at all. So, okay, we're gonna grab the hourglass. All right, let's just say the hourglass. So she was supposedly getting my mother. She was channeling my mother. Why would my mother choose my brother years ago had a collection of 5 or 6 hourglasses that meant nothing to her,
and
to me.
It hadn't been published anywhere.
Oh, no, it's nothing. He had a bunch on the show. He likes watches, expensive watches, and he had for a while a few hourglasses. So, anyway, it was just really interesting to see Gary Schwartz's reaction and mine, and I kind of said, well, that's not a very meaningful thing, and you know, he collects watches, he had a few hourglasses, and he said, you expect it to be specific, you're such a jerk. anyway, it's an interesting, you know, if you tend toward believing, you grab onto what fits, and if you're, you don't tend toward believing, you look at the things that don't fit. It's like, you know, the horoscope. If you want it to fit, it fits. If you don't, it doesn't. That's like that.
Okay. What did you find in your investigations with this project? What did you find to be the most challenging to explain, or the most
Yeah, I think that the closest anyone's gotten to producing that kind of material that makes me go, yeah, how did that happen? Is some of the near-death experience work, which specifically I liked the there was, I forget which researcher, if it was Grayson or who, I don't think it was Grayson, but what this person did is he had a control group and he had a bunch of people who had had a near-death experience where they were seeing what was happening to them on the operating table. And he asked them to, them plus a control group, he said, describe what you saw in as much detail as you can. And the people who had the near-death experience, it was very, very medically detailed and actually, as it turned out, accurate. And
in terms of the tools,
I mean, if I had the book here, I mean, they were really very specific with the way that the needle had two sides and they were pushing with the heel, you know, it wasn't just, oh, they were pumping on my chest in there, you know, it was very, very, very specific. And the control people, like, trying to describe what was happening, I was like,
the conversations that were happening in the room as well.
Possibly, this one was specifically, what did you see?
Right.
The control group, it was like chimpanzees were running the operating room. It was way off base. So if you take that study at face value, it was impressive to me, you know. And then that, I don't know, you know, who knows? But I don't know how. And they weren't people with a medical background, any of them. So and then some of the there were, you know, there were people who studied blind people who had near-death experiences, so that body of research. I loved kind of the ingenuity that was applied to it. It just took it a little bit beyond the realm of anecdote, which it is usually presented in. There was also Bruce Grayson's computer up by the top of the operating. This was a study, because people tend to see themselves from above, looking down at the operating table. What Bruce Grayson did, he took the operating room at, I guess, the UVA Medical Center, where defibrillators are put in. When you put in a defibrillator, you have to test it and make sure it works. And so you're kind of putting somebody in the kind of scenario where there would be a near-death experience. So he's like, he chose those patients, and he had a laptop computer open, and there was a randomly generated image, simple image. And he put it up on top of the bank of lights that's in an OR, facing the ceiling. So if you did float up there, you'd be looking down at the computer. Otherwise, you wouldn't see it. So everyone who came out of the operating room would be interviewed, and it would just say, do you remember anything? And so for about 6 months to a year after I'd been there, my publications getting closer, I kept writing to Bruce Grayson saying, did anybody see anything? Because that would have been pretty awesome if somebody did. Nobody did. In fact, nobody did. Because of the anesthesia, he said, because I guess it was a percent or something, there was a shift in the anesthetic, and nobody remembers anything. So there wasn't anything. Nobody remembered anything, let alone a near-death experience. So nobody had a near-death experience. Nobody floated up, nothing. So that was a big disappointment.
Yeah.
That would have been cool. But,
I remember having conversations with some parapsychologists, some of the work that I've done, they said that while they're not necessarily amenable to controlled systematic empirical investigations, because they're oftentimes one-off sort of phenomena, you can't just conjure them up, or just because you want to subject them to some sort of controlled laboratory conditions, they don't obey the
natural. Yeah, right. That's often a kind of an excuse of, like, you can't make it happen, it happens when it happens. Like, if you test a medium, the medium is like, yeah, I don't know, I'm having a bad day.
So at the end of it, what would you say in terms of your work in this area? Did it change your mind? Is this a worthy program of research in terms of the continuation of studies on life after death?
I don't know how else you come at it in an empirical way. attract a kind of person who perhaps wasn't coming at it from a neutral place. I mean, that certainly felt like the case with Dr. Roach in India. Although, you know, he did make the point that this is not a strong case, and you could see flaws and could see where stories weren't matching up. I mean, he wasn't completely taken by any of it. But and you know, if you've got money from Chester Carlson and it's earmarked for that, why not? Go ahead. You know.
Yeah. But at the end of it, you say that you you kind of end on this what you call the big shrug.
I certainly didn't come across. Well, there were things I found. The things that made more sense to me were the explanations. There were some really interesting explanations for phenomena. They were not paranormal explanations. There was some really interesting work that this guy Vic Tandy had done with infrasound and how that might cause people to sense, or Michael Persinger with a helmet, that you can subtly do things to the brain that cause sensations of someone in the room, or just peculiar sensations, or
you know. So you manipulate the electromagnetic energy levels.
Right, or the infrasound.
The person's in the room with you.
Yes, a lot of people reported that. I personally didn't with the helmet.
Yeah.
Did you take care of the helmet? Did you wear the helmet?
I'm aware of it.
The helmet, yeah. Anyway, those explanations seem to make a little more sense to me, and were interesting explanations for common things that people feel that seem strange.
But you get one of the hurdles, I think, for you in terms of buying into the more supernatural, paranormal explanations is just simply your rapid attachment to rationality, which I can sympathize with that. I mean, you talk about, for instance, you know, the near-death experiments. What exactly is somebody perceiving these images of this flat laptop screen with when they have no visual cortex that's operating at that moment?
Right.
What are they seeing with they have no?
Yeah, it's you know, I talk about, you know, Occam's razor in the sense that the simplest explanation is probably the real explanation. But for many people, I dreamed about my grandfather, then he died. Or for many people, the paranormal explanation feels simplest to them. Whereas I'm like, how did your grandfather, how is he communicating? How's it getting into your head? How is he even thinking without a memory or a brain? How is that, you know, it's like God. I can't, you know, God is to me, who made God? You know, that, like, how is God watching everybody? How is that make sense?
God has mental states in the absence of the brain.
These things raise more questions for me than they answer. But for other people, they are acceptable answers, and what I might posit seems hopelessly complicated and overly technical. I don't know.
So do you think that maybe that's one of the core differences between people, that we all have the same sort of intuitions about the supernatural, but some of us specifically don't buy into our own inclinations and sort of the way that the directions that our minds go when these things happen, we interrogate them more. We are less prone to trust ourselves.
I think there are individual differences in cognition and brains and that steer people toward believing and not believing. There's whole books on that I didn't write.
Yes. Okay, so I guess, you know, I want to spend a little bit of time just opening up the floor for conversation here with you guys, giving you a chance to ask Mary some questions, especially about this particular topic, the afterlife.
And Jesse as well. I mean, he knows more about it than I do.
Slightly different angle, but yes.
Yes. Yeah. Yes.
Does anybody have a question that they'd like to pose to Mary about her work on
the paranormal.
A question there in the middle. Can you get a
microphone? You spoke earlier about visions of the afterlife, and I was wondering what your thoughts on research about DMT being the cause of those visions.
I'm sorry, could you repeat that?
You spoke earlier about the versions of the afterlife or experiences.
Yes.
And I was wondering what you thought about DMT being the cause of the visions.
About what DMT?
DMT?
Yeah. The DMT is the chemical relationship that you bring when you die.
What's DMT?
I have not been part of it.
It's the spirit molecule, it's a hallucinogen. Yeah.
Oh, okay.
It allegedly opens the doors of perception so you can see the other side.
But it's released by the pineal
gland,
so it has synthetic and natural occurrences in nature, but it is released by the brain. Okay. Yeah, I'm not familiar with DMT. So I don't know the answer to your question.
Although, Michael, that would be a good question for you.
Well, I haven't tried it personally, but it's supposed to be really good.
Okay, I think we've got a couple questions, one in the back here.
When you wrote Stiff, what was the audience that you were expecting? And was it broader than you had expected? And if so, why do you think that was?
When I wrote Stiff, I couldn't really imagine a scenario where someone would go into a bookstore and look at a table of new releases and go, oh, this book about cadavers, that's what I'm going to need. So I felt very bad for my publisher that they made a terrible mistake, that nobody would buy this book, like this book, read this book. That was my expectation. It was a complete surprise that the book did well.
New York Times bestseller,
it was.
So how do you explain that?
A couple of things. First of all, because we all die, I think that we all die, there's a built-in kind of fascination and curiosity for what's to come. And I think the other thing about that book is that it's a funny book, but it's a book about cadavers, and I think people got talking. The books sell well because people talk about it, and people are like, oh, this is kind of weird, it's about cadavers, it's kind of funny, you should try it. I think that is why.
It gave people permission.
Yeah, and also the other thing is that, and this was just coincidental, the book came out right around the time Six Feet Under debuted and CSI, so you turn on the TV, there were bodies on the slab everywhere. And so I think it gave people permission to be curious and to talk about cadavers and death. And I think that people need and want to just kind of demystify it. So maybe that was what was going on. It was just sort of a cultural moment that I stepped into at the right time, perhaps.
Yeah. Right here.
You mentioned the operating room and the computer. What are some of the other ways that people try to investigate the afterlife?
Going back historically, one of my favorite was Duncan McDougall, who was a Massachusetts physician in the early 1900s. He worked at a tuberculosis sanitarium, so he had a ready supply of dying humans, and he got curious about the soul and does it have substance. So he had this giant, I don't know if you knew somebody who had this scale, it was a giant silk scale of weighing fabric, and he installed a bed on the scale, and he would put the dying, you kind of tell when somebody's gearing up to die, you put the person on, you look at the needle to see if it would go down a little bit, which is, a ridiculous, it's not an enclosed system, it's why would the soul weigh, what is it, 3/4 of a, what's the 21 grams? Really heavy for a soul. But anyway, I loved Duncan and Google just that he did this, that he built the scale, that he published it in American Scientist. So that's one. Duke University, Jerry Napier, who was trying to come do a modern day version of that with an enclosed system in which he wanted to put a leech in it because he hates leeches. So he put the leech in. I don't know how the leech dies, but anyway, you have a very, very sensitive, picogram sensitive scale. You have an array of electromagnetic energy detectors, and you have, and if it doesn't all add up, it means something's missing, and that's the soul. He didn't do it. He needed funding. He went to the Catholic Church and tried to get them to do it. Again,
the soul is a physical thing.
As energy that's gone, energy information that is now missing. So a little more sophisticated than Dr. McDougall, but not that. And Jerry Nahum, he's actually a gynecologist at Duke University with a background in consciousness theory and quantum mechanics.
Is that the inspiration for Bob?
No. Jerry Nahum was, he's the kind of guy listening to him talk, I would in my head be going, either this guy is brilliant or fucking nuts. I don't know, one or the other. But he never, I shouldn't have said that, you're recording, sorry. So Jerry Nahum, he said he could do it for $100,000, and nobody gave him the money. As far as I know, Jerry never did his experiment. But
how much does the soul of a leech weigh?
And does the leech have a soul? No, it was an interesting project. So there's that, there's...
ectoplasm?
Ectoplasm, that was the era of ectoplasm. That was the spiritual era, the 1910s, 1920s, where seances, mediums were people who were speaking to the beyond and also manifesting physical matter that was sort of tangible, supposed to be tangible evidence of psychic energy, of bodies, etc. So the mediums there was a cabinet, and then you pull the curtain, and you open it up, and it's dark in the room, and then there'd be this stuff, that kind of like spewing out or hanging off of them. And what was, and to me, you look at the photographs, and you're like, that's just cheesecloth or sheep's organs or something, which it was. But at the time, it was taken very seriously with the Sorbonne, the Scientific American, and there were Nobel laureates, and people were taking ectoplasm seriously. At one point, this researcher, I love this, this is, I think, my favorite line in the book. The medium is communicating with the beyond, and there's ectoplasm, which was cheesecloth that had been regurgitated, actually, as it turned out. But the guy who doesn't realize that it's cheesecloth says, has the medium ask the deceased in the beyond, he said, it appears in places as though woven. Have you a loom in your world? Anyway, so I the Society for Psychical Research, which just, they did, I love them. Society for Psychical Research, the archives, really fun, interesting. And they gave all of their stuff to Cambridge University. I don't know if Cambridge, maybe a little embarrassing for Cambridge University, but anyway, all the archives are there, and I was looking through the archive, and there is a box of alleged ectoplasm at Cambridge University. So I flew all the way over there to spend time, because you're in the manuscript, the manuscript's room is this kind of ancient room with people studying Darwin's seed stock and medieval land transfers, and they're very serious students, and a page will go and fetch stuff for you. So I had this box, and it had the little card at the top that said alleged ectoplasm.
From the 1930s, I think.
Yes. Smelling faintly, vaginally secreted, slightly stained. And I'm like, I had to open that up, and Cambridge made it. It was a fun anyway. Ectoplasm, which wasn't really a scientific investigation, but it was supposedly, here's the proof.
Tēnā koe, Mary. Just would like to hear your skeptic's take on what, if you have one, of what near-death experiences are.
Well, experiences? They
near-death experiences.
Near-death experiences.
Oh, of what they are. I don't know. I don't know. Either there's theories that it has to do with the drugs used in anesthesia, but then why would those drugs cause it, you know, all the time when they're used? There's the lack of oxygen to the brain theory. There's the you traveled outside and looked down theory. Those are the three main. I mean, what other explanations are there on both sides?
Well, the anesthesia is that they're actually less likely to experience your death experiences when they're under anesthesia.
Mm-hmm.
I guess that's in favor of the paranormal.
Yes, right. Yeah. But those are the two.
Sort of, yeah. Those are the two that you hear as possible other explanations. I can't see over here. The light is blinding me. But if there's any questions,
okay.
Cheers. A thought that's occurred to me when we're talking about near-death experiences is obviously something you have investigated. Are there cultural differences and cultural consistencies? Yeah, consistencies across cultures, and are there differences across cultures?
Yeah.
What have you discovered?
Yeah, that's fascinating. Thanks. That there are some wonderful cultural differences. For example, Bruce Grayson mentioned. You know, the tunnel that you go down, there was a long haul trucker who described it as going down a tailpipe. There was a Chinese individual who described, you know, the moment where they say it's not your time and you have to go back. He was told there's been a clerical error in the paperwork. So yeah, there are some cultural. Can you think of other cultural differences? Yeah. It's almost as though it's a similar experience, and then you overlay your own cultural interpretation to it. Yeah.
It's similar to the sleep paralysis research area, where people feel like they're awake but they can't move, and some entity is somehow sitting on their chest. Or in their environment with them, and that is sensitive to the sort of cultural scripts that they're embedded in. So it used to be the case during the age of spiritualism that there's a ghost or a demon or something sitting on your chest, and then in the 1970s or 80s it was more aliens that were visiting from outer space that were doing experiments on you and sitting on your chest, or witches, you know, that sort of thing. And it was variable depending on the nature of the particular sort of rhetoric or scripts culturally at that time. So I would imagine something similar to that in terms of how we color our near-death experiences. But, that's an empirical question.
There's a question here.
Hi,
Mary.
Hi. If you go right back through recorded history, you know, thousands of years ago, they were building tombs with food for the afterlife of the people there. So it seems that there's almost a universal desire to believe in the afterlife amongst humans. Any thoughts on why that is so?
Who wants to stop living? Mm. I mean, I think it's just it's a lovely thing to believe. I don't know beyond that.
Well, I would say it's a kind of illusion. I think we do have this motivation to believe because it's nice to think that you survive our own biological death, but it's also difficult psychologically to escape the sense that somehow our minds survive our own psychological oblivion. If you try to imagine what it's like to be dead, you can't really do that. It's like Freud said, you're sort of a spectator in your own, that's observing your own biological termination, and you see other people responding to your body and so on. It's impossible to escape that sense. So it might be simply a blip in our cognitive hardware. I think it's alongside this desire.
Mm-hmm.
we've got time for maybe three more questions.
Just follow up. So is there a view on pre-incarnation and thinking about the life before rather than the life after?
Oh, do people believe in pre-incarnation? Yeah, right.
Yeah, there's not a lot of sort of systematic investigation in that area aside from sort of theological scripture.
Right. A little difficult to investigate.
I mean, that would articulate with the reincarnation-based research program, I guess, with Jim Tucker and Ruth Grayson's work.
Right. I mean, anybody who looks into it is kind of looking at it from the pre-incarnate, like,
yeah,
who this person used to be rather than who are you going to be. But there's also, I have a cousin who, she does past life regression, and she said that there's actually now a between life regression, that there's a whole separate market for regressing you to, there's a little brief in between.
Right.
I don't know what goes on now, but that's another
process.
That out of that.
This is one question I'd like to raise with you, and that is that in the Egyptian collection in Munich, there is a collection of mummies that are on display, and what I thought was most unusual was that they pointed out to you that in looking at these mummies, you were doing the very thing that those people would have most disliked to have happened to them after death, because the boxes had been opened and all this had been on display.
Yes.
I thought there was a very interesting thing, because the idea that that this is all an illusion that these people are operating under. When Wittgenstein took people apart on this one, because he said, you're just trying to say that those experiences are different from eating and preparing food and doing things of this kind. You must be familiar with this argument. And I thought it was interesting that the German Museum had moved in the direction of saying, well, just a moment, this culture didn't feel like that about what you're doing. And what you normally come and do and say, oh, you know, mummies, who cares? That's a very interesting thing.
Yeah.
I'm not sure where you go from there.
Yeah. Well, yeah. I'm not sure either. what came to mind, which has really not that much to do with what you just said, is that the hesitation a lot of people, including my husband, have about donating their body to science. They believe that it's a good thing, an altruistic thing, an important thing to help research. But the sense that people are going to be looking at you, it's like, if you leave my underwear on, that's fine. that sense of you're dead and you don't look your best.
Well, it actually reminds me a little bit of this is sort of a grim anecdote, for example.
Let's end on that.
Yeah. There was an ancient Roman civilization in a small town where there was an epidemic of, because I wrote my last book on the psychology of suicide, and there was a case of teenage girls, sort of an epidemic of suicide in that community, and somebody had the idea to curb the suicide rate by basically parading the naked corpses of the suicide victims around the town square, and that was actually quite effective.
Yes, it's like the don't do meth, or it'll give you acne. What is it? There's a public service
whatever it is,
campaign. Like. Yeah, it just shows here you can get acne and your teeth fall out, and it's very effective.
So somehow there's this, even if we don't necessarily explicitly believe that we're going to psychological experience, other people looking at our courses, it's still a very unsettling thought. And I think that has to do with just their attention for taking the perspective of ourselves in the future, even though we don't have a functioning brain to be analyzing that scene.
Right.
Hi. I've been going for this book, so yeah. I'm wondering, as that stands out the most while writing Spook in particular, that you just like, I am writing about this? Like, just was like, oh my god. You've shared some today, but is anything most interesting?
It's Spook specifically. Well, I got pretty excited about the alleged ectoplasm in the box. That was pretty much booked my ticket to the UK right away. That one.
You didn't talk about where she was secreting her.
Oh, vaginally secreting. Yeah. I initially misread it as secreting, but in fact it was secret. Secreting. So that one. Sorry, I thought I said that. Yeah, no. So that was exciting for me. When I started the book, I had no intention of spending any time with the paranormal researchers who go around with Radio Shack EMF meters saying, whoa, this room is haunted, you know, and having no idea what causes an EMF meter to go off on the variety of other things that it might be. But I couldn't resist one of them because it was a group that was going out to the site of the Donner Party in the Sierra.
they were gonna, you guys know what that is?
Yeah, maybe you know, the Donner Party was like, it's a sort of the most famous case of mass cannibalism. It's a sad story. They were stuck. They were sent to a pass that didn't exist. They got stuck in the snow game. Ended up cannibalizing some of their party. But anyway, so they were going to collect electronic voice phenomena of the Donner Party. I can't miss this. Plus, and then it paid off for me just in that when we pulled up to the part that in the Sierras where the Donner Party was, there's a National Forest Service, the classic wood with the yellow letters, which is a classic American Forest Service sign, and it says Donner Camp Picnic Ground.
Wrap their heads around nervous.
everyone for joining us tonight, and thank you, Mary Roach, the Mary Roach. She will be around on Sunday after Michael Shermer's talk.